Orion presents The Way From Here by Jane Turner. Read by Charlotte Strevens. Part 1. September 2011. The Finish. The end of the drive phase of the stroke, when the blade is extracted from the water by tapping down. In coaching, it is often thought helpful to consider it as the start of the recovery phase, rather than the end of the drive phase. Chapter 1. Kate. Pontefract, the blue sign flashed past. I'm not supposed to be here. How did that happen? Kate glanced at the sat-nav perched on the dashboard. The screen was black. The cable hung free, guiltily. Oh, fuck, she said to herself, as a mounting sense of dread tightened its grip on her chest. Fuck, fuck, fuck. Breathe, Kate. You can do this. Ella was plugged into her headphones, oblivious to the impending crisis. Kate tapped her gently on the thigh to attract her attention. What? Asked Ella irritably, as she dragged the speakers away from her ears. I must have taken a wrong turn. We're in Pontefract, and we're not supposed to be. Can you look at the map for me? Mum, we'll be late, wailed Ella. I'll miss registration, and everyone will have made friends, and I'll have to spend the next 3 years on my own. If Kate didn't love her daughter quite so much, right at that moment, she could have found her a bit of a brat. But she did love her, and Ella was entitled to be stressed about starting university. Allowances needed to be made. It's in the pocket behind my seat. The map. Ella was tapping away at her phone. Oh, Mumsy! You're so last century! No one uses maps anymore. That stung. She was quite sure if Tim had been driving, he'd have insisted Ella map read the whole way, old school. Perhaps she should have done the same. But then Ella would have puffed and sighed, and that really wasn't what she wanted today of all days. Even if Ella had been map reading, they might still have missed the turn after so many hours on a straight road. No doubt Kate had been lost in thought at the crucial moment, relying on her dodgy technology to prompt her when the turn was imminent. That was the problem with a long journey. Too much time to think. Ella had expressed surprise at how far it was to Durham, a fact that had clearly escaped her when she was filling in her UCAS forms. In fact, it had been news to Ella that you could go that far north and still be in England. So much for her A star in GCSE geography. If she'd intended to put distance between herself and her mother, she'd certainly succeeded. No harm done. We'll still be there in bags of time. She squeezed her daughter's arm and smiled encouragingly at her. My app says we should be there at 16:52. There you are. You'll be fine. And Kate plugged in the sat-nav again, giving the connector an extra shove for good measure. Planning the trip, Kate had imagined a memorable experience she and her daughter would look back on fondly in years to come. It wasn't quite working out that way, and Ella wasn't helping. She hadn't removed her headphones since they left Bath, so frankly, might as well have not been in the car. It seemed ridiculous to admit that Ella's leaving had come as a shock, as she'd had 18 years to get used to the idea. In fairness, there had been considerable uncertainty over whether Ella would have done well enough to go to university that year. Once she'd had her results, there had been a week or so of celebration, and then the rest of the time had been filled with all the preparations needed for the next stage of her life. Printers and vaccinations, kettles and dental appointments. Kate did know deep down that Ella could still go to university with a residual amount of stubborn plaque and would survive the experience. However, oral hygiene was one of the few things she could still control in Ella's life. She remembered the summer before Poppy, Ella's older sister, had started senior school. Kate had experienced a recurring nightmare that it was the first day of term and she hadn't finished sewing name tapes on her daughter's uniform. It had finally dawned on Kate that her anxiety wasn't actually about the name tapes. This time there was no gym kit to be named, but Kate could still contrive to make a long list of tasks without which she was sure her daughter could not possibly thrive. Their most important appointment had been their lunch yesterday at Ella's favourite restaurant. The beginning and end of every term at school had been marked by chicken katsu, and Ella did not want to stop the tradition now. Kate had been so pleased her daughter didn't feel she'd grown out of the habit. Whilst knowing she had to let her daughter go, Kate still wanted to hang on to some keepsakes of her childhood. This meal would always be one of them. Driving at 50 miles per hour on the M1, past endless orange cones, listening to Ella humming along to some unknown melody, Kate could finally stop worrying about her lists and confront what was happening. Her younger child was leaving for university. From now on, she would be completely alone all week, and at weekends, it would just be her and Tim. And it would be like that until Christmas. She noticed she was chewing absent-mindedly at the side of her finger. The nail was already gnawed down to the quick. Frustrated with herself, she placed her hand firmly back on the steering wheel and heaved a sigh. Ella reached across with a perfectly manicured hand and patted her mother's leg.
"It's fine, Mum. I'm going to be just fine. You really don't have to worry about me."
"I know, darling. Don't mind me. I just wish there weren't so many bollards." Kate looked at her daughter, singing along to the silent music. "We are young. Let's live our lives strong and free." She looked happy. She was so obviously ready for university, excited about meeting new people and exploring the world beyond the bubble she'd grown up in. She was also enthusiastic about her subject, which always helped. No doubt she would find a way to negotiate all the challenges that lay ahead. It was funny how everyone seemed to think Kate should be worried about how Ella would cope. Tim was concerned. He kept asking Kate if she thought Ella would be okay, seeking reassurance, which Kate gladly provided. No, she was not worried about Ella. This was so obviously the right thing for her. Ella was going to be just fine. She'd miss her. Of course she would. Out of choice, she'd probably have spent her entire life hugging her children and breathing in the smell of them. But little by little, from that first day she'd left Poppy at the nursery to go back to work, she'd learnt to accept and adjust to the physical separation. Kate remembered the raw, visceral pain she'd experienced as she made herself walk away from the cheery nanny holding her baby, her breasts leaking into the freshly laundered bra so carefully selected for her return to the workplace. It was her first lesson as a mother in letting go. She knew it had to be done. It was Poppy's first lesson in learning to trust the world and to feel secure in it without her mother's comforting presence. Step by step over the years, Kate had ever so gradually given her girls the opportunity to extend their orbit further and further away from her. Always they came back to her, the centre of their universe, for encouragement and reassurance. But as they grew, they needed to check in less often. Poppy had already been at university for 2 years, and in term time she generally only called once a week. But when she was upset or in trouble, or when she had some good news to share, it was Kate she reached out to. The bond was not broken. It was as strong as ever, even if it was invisible much of the time. Kate had done her job well. She knew that. Poppy was thriving, and Ella would do the same. If a mother's goal was to eventually make herself obsolete, she was right on track. If one day her children had to manage without her, she knew they would not just survive, but would flourish. No, Kate's anxiety had nothing to do with Ella. It didn't seem to have occurred to anyone, least of all Tim, that what she was actually worried about was herself. She was well aware the endless tasks concerning Ella's departure were a sort of displacement activity. She felt she was standing at the edge of a yawning chasm, a great belching black void of nothingness that was drawing her towards it. What was to become of her? What had become of her? Kate had been so busy making a place in the world for her daughters, she'd somehow forgotten along the way to take care of herself. The life she'd ended up with was not the life she'd planned. Everything was a compromise. She'd been so full of optimism and ambition all those years ago on her own first day at university. She'd been the first pupil from her comprehensive to storm Cambridge's ivy-clad courts, and she'd believed the glittering prizes were hers for the taking. She was going to be a human rights lawyer, respected, fulfilled, making a difference. And yet, here she was, with her niche, mummy-track job, processing endless identical claims for clients. It was one unfulfilling Groundhog Day after another. The worst part was she felt it was almost impossible to voice her frustration. Uninspiring it might be, but it was still a decently paid, flexible job that had allowed her to work 3 days a week and to be the parent on call for the girls 24/7. She was well aware many of her friends envied her. It just wasn't the life she'd imagined for herself. Then there was her marriage. Kate sighed again as she took stock. Tim was a good man, a good father, and a good provider. Her mother considered it a good marriage. But then Kate was not willing to burden her or anyone else with descriptions of her loneliness. It had seemed a sensible enough decision after the girls were born for Tim to stay in London during the week for his job while Kate made their home in Bath. She hadn't foreseen how the arrangement would set them on separate paths, which would eventually lead to a massive gulf between them. You make one simple decision, and eventually, one day, you find yourself in bloody Pontefract when you were supposed to be going to Durham. So many times over the years, Kate had made this mental checklist. She knew she should be grateful for what she had, yet somehow, she couldn't help feeling there was supposed to be more. To an outsider, she was the girl who had everything. The house, the job, the husband, the kids. It's all just so disappointing. Still, it was a glorious day for a long drive. After a slightly underwhelming summer, just as the days were shortening and the nights turning cold, the sky had turned a brilliant and positively un-English blue. For days now, they'd been bathed in sunshine, the strength of which had taken everyone by surprise. Kate mused about the way people obsessed about summer. They spent so much time planning for it and talking about it. Then, when it finally arrived, it was so often disappointing. But just as they thought it was all over and were packing away their barely used paraphernalia of fine weather, they discovered the best was yet to come. They finally pulled into Ella's college in the late afternoon. As they walked up to the main building, hand in hand, Kate felt Ella's palm clammy in hers. Her normally self-assured daughter was working hard to hold it together. Kate was also feeling intimidated. Once upon a time, she'd been so sure of herself and so full of courage. At Cambridge, she'd dived headfirst into an exotic world with a language all of its own, full of bedders and butteries. She remembered striding into drinks parties full of strangers, apparently the only girl present not wearing a pearl necklace. She'd never seen anyone in pearls before who wasn't someone's mother. It made her laugh. She'd been fearless in those days. She wondered what had become of that girl and how she'd turned into such an anxious, apologetic old woman. It was as if, as her children grew, she herself had been diminished. As they sucked the milk from her breast, somehow the life force had drained away from her. As Poppy and Ella developed into beautiful, poised young women, so Kate had been reduced to this lesser version of herself. Conscious of her daughter's nervousness, she started talking a little too fast, telling Ella how lovely the college and grounds were. In fact, how lovely everything was. She said hello to everyone they passed, possibly a little too enthusiastically. It was as if she were back at Ella's first day at infant school. Then she had told herself, so long as she doesn't wet her pants, everything will be okay. It didn't feel too far from the mark this time. It didn't occur to her that, ironically, despite all the pelvic floor exercises, she was actually the one most at risk of this humiliation. As they carried on up the path, Kate was conscious of the heads turning back to check out her daughter as they passed. Ella was tall like her mother, with the same long, rangy legs. Her streaky blonde hair was long and straight, the way Kate's had been in her youth. She'd finally cut it short the third time she caught nits when Poppy was in nursery. Ella was the spit of her mother in old photographs, with the same sharp cheekbones and generous mouth. From her barely concealed smile, Kate could tell she was enjoying the attention. She remembered from her youth what it felt like to be the focus of men's gaze, how powerful it had made her feel. Their attention had drifted away so gradually, she only realized it had gone when she first found them staring past her at one of her daughters. Two more male students walked past, and one was so distracted by staring at Ella, he tripped over a paving stone and had to be hauled back to his feet by his friend. Kate noticed Ella standing fractionally taller, her shoulders pushed back ever so slightly. Then there was the unmistakable hair toss. Kate smiled to herself, but even as she did so, she felt herself drooping, momentarily defeated. Ella glanced at her mother and then stopped and embraced her in a hug. "Don't worry, Mum. I'm going to be fine." Kate laughed and freed herself from her daughter's hold and rummaged in her bag for a tissue. She blew her nose and said, "I know you are, darling. Ignore me. I'm just being silly." Today was about Ella. The black pit drawing her in would have to wait. Having collected the key to Ella's room, they hauled the endless bags and boxes up three flights of stairs. Once everything had been moved, Kate decided it was time to christen the kettle and make some tea. Somehow, the milk was still stacked in the fridge at home, along with the fruit juice and smoothies they'd selected so carefully from the supermarket. How had she forgotten them? She could kick herself. She'd wanted everything to be perfect, and she couldn't even remember the sodding milk. At least they'd remembered the brownies and wine. Kate remembered enough about her own Freshers' Week to know that social anxiety was eased by cake and alcohol, and she had packed a copious supply of both. Ella was dispatched to knock on her neighbour's doors and scavenge for milk. While she waited for the kettle to boil, Kate stood looking out at the view from the large sash windows. There was no doubt it was an enchanting spot. The college lawn swept down from the accommodation block, past mature chestnut trees, until they reached a red brick boathouse, ornamented with white timber gingerbread and topped by a flagpole. Massive doors at one end opened onto an expanse of concrete, and a series of narrow terraces led down to a wooden dock. The River Weir swept past the pontoon and off into the distance, magnificent and stately. As she stood admiring the light playing seductively on the surface of the water, a women's eight rowed past, doing slow, firm. Kate caught her breath. It was something she hadn't witnessed for nearly 30 years. It was a sight so familiar and so dear, it came as a shock to see it again. She almost found herself trying to identify her old crew from their distant outline. Was that Hattie at bow, or Paula at seven? These young women could have been the students she'd rowed with all those years ago. The image was timeless. Suddenly Kate found herself choking up with emotion. She was overwhelmed by a yearning to return, to be the one embarking on a new chapter of her life. She wanted to be the one going to Freshers' Fair and signing up for new experiences, forging new friendships and exploring new terrain. She wanted to feel again that excitement, that enthusiasm, that passion. The sudden longing was almost unbearable. Later, having said her goodbyes and kissed her daughter for the last time, Kate made her way back to the car. Fortunately, Ella had assumed Kate's tears were for her. There were occasionally advantages to the adolescent's egocentric view of life. The light was fading. She sat with both hands on the steering wheel, but made no attempt to start the engine. She was quite alone. Somewhere in the city, a budget hotel was expecting her, but the thought gave her no comfort. She would be on her own in the efficient but soulless room, just as she would be when she arrived home tomorrow. Now, there was no avoiding it. The abyss was right in front of her. It was impossible to see a way forward, to find a reason to continue. Everything looked so bleak. Her phone burst into life with a perky tune. Tim. "Hiya, all well?" she asked, putting on a pretense of cheeriness. "I can't find the mango chutney. Are we out of it?" "There's a jar in the fridge. Top shelf. You'll have to move things around to see it. You got there okay? Traffic not too bad?" "Yes, fine." Kate decided not to mention Pontefract. "I just said goodbye to Ella. I'm off to look for the hotel." "How was she?" "Settling in okay? No tears, I hope." "Not from her. No, she's absolutely fine. It's really lovely here. I wish I could have taken her. I feel I'm missing out. I simply couldn't afford to take tomorrow off, not with this client meeting. God knows whether I can sort things out with them." "Oh, I'm sure you will. You always do. You're good at your job, sweetheart. And clients love you." "Well, yes. We'll see. Top shelf, you say? Better go. See you Friday. Have a good week." And he rang off. "And how are you doing, Kate?" she asked herself. She had thought she couldn't feel more alone than she had 5 minutes earlier. But somehow the call from Tim had made it a whole lot worse. She sat for a long time, staring through the windscreen. The river shimmered in the last rays of the setting sun, but Kate looked straight past it into nothing. She wished tears would come again, as a good cry might help, but she was beyond that. Finally, she roused herself, blew her nose, and gave herself a stern talking to. "You're just going to have to get a grip. Find something else to do. Something to fill your life." She thought of the women in her book club, who'd taken up a variety of hobbies in recent years. One woman had explained how golf really helped to take my mind off the menopause. Another friend had been obsessed first by sailing, then gardening, then had finally found Jesus. The memory made her smile, but none of those would do. She didn't just want something to fill the time. She wanted something she was passionate about. Most of all, she wanted to recapture the person she used to be. Suddenly, with a fierce clarity, Kate realized that if she were to escape the dark chasm, she had to make it happen. And just then, the women's eight came back into view, rowing back to where they'd come from. Backstops. The ready position. The rower sits with a straight back, leaning backwards slightly. Legs are flat and straight. The blade is held flat on the water with the handle against the body. This is the position the rower adopts immediately before commencing rowing. Chapter 2. Kate. From Women's Captain at AlbionRowingClub.org. "Good to hear from you, Kate. We're always on the lookout for experienced rowers. Our senior women's eight are going out at 8 a.m. this Saturday, if you'd like to try out." "Are you sure this is a good idea?" Tim's shaved head was buried in the fridge as he foraged for fuel for his cycle ride. He emerged, clutching a couple of pork pies and a scotch egg. He was tall and skinny, and his stretchy cycle gear somehow exaggerated his resemblance to a pipe cleaner. "I mean, should you be doing this?"
"Should I be doing this?"
Kate was already doubting herself. Getting ready had been a nightmare.
Makeup?
No makeup. She didn't want them to think she was some sort of gym buddy who worked out in thick war paint.
Oh, God! What am I doing?
This was possibly the 100th time she'd asked herself this question. And what on earth to wear? If only her girls were at home, they'd know exactly what to do. She really missed them at times like this. At Cambridge, she'd worn a motley collection of rugby shirts nicked from boyfriends and baggy tracksuit bottoms. They'd festered in a large pile in a corner of her room, like a gently steaming compost heap. She hadn't been as hot on laundry in those days. Back then, it wasn't done to try too hard with what you wore. Admittedly, when only 10% of students were female, it was the men that did the chasing. It was all so different now. Young women seemed to try hard all of the time. It was as if they had to be Instagram ready at every waking moment, their hair freshly straightened and their eyeliner perfectly applied. Vigorous physical activity was clearly incompatible with this level of grooming. Kate had not been surprised when she'd read somewhere how few of her daughter's generation took part in sport. Disappointed, yes, but not surprised.
Plain black lycra, not the Lululemon.
Kate could almost hear her daughter's voice. That was one problem solved. It was fortunate she'd allowed plenty of time, as the way into the club was not obvious. Don't they want people to join? The entrance was through a gate at the end of a lane overgrown with nettles. A placard hung on the rusted metal bars announced Albion Rowing Club beneath a faded crest. The river remained hidden. She headed over to what looked like an agricultural outbuilding clad in corrugated iron. Surrounded by fields, it was eerily quiet. There were half a dozen boats on trestles in front and a number of people milling about. No one paid her any attention. As she reached the building, she hesitated. She looked for an eight, but couldn't see one amongst the boats outside. Stepping into the gloomy boat shed, she could just make out a group of women at the far end. The rough concrete floor was thick with dust and clods of mud.
"Excuse me, I'm looking for the senior women, or the women's captain?" asked Kate.
The women stopped talking and stared at her. Kate cringed under their scrutiny.
"She's down by the river. She'll be here in a minute," said one,
and they resumed their conversation without missing a beat. Kate tried to make herself invisible. They were having a debrief on the night before and dissecting what one of the group may or may not have done with one of the men's first eight. It was like listening to Poppy and Ella with their mates. In fact, all the women were young enough to be Kate's daughters. They had long, swishy ponytails and were dressed almost identically. Kate was wearing the wrong leggings and the wrong fleece. It was all a terrible mistake. She didn't belong here. Finally, a wiry-looking woman in her early 30s appeared.
"Oh, you're not what I was expecting."
Kate had debated whether to say how old she was in her email to the club, but had settled on, "I stroked my college first eight at Cambridge, but haven't rowed for a while."
"Sorry, I'm the women's captain. I see you've met the rest of the crew. Everyone, this is Kate. Kate rowed at Cambridge and is here to see if we're good enough for her."
This was said without a trace of irony.
"Is Beth here yet?"
A woman with auburn hair replied,
"This is Beth we're talking about. She's only 5 minutes late at the moment. Give it another quarter of an hour."
This produced a chorus of cackles from the group. Kate made a mental note to give that particular rower a wide berth.
"Well, let's get the boat out," said the captain. "Hopefully, our cox will be here by the time we're ready. Hands on!"
Everyone strode off to the next bay in the boathouse and ranged themselves along the length of a yellow eight, resting upside down on wooden supports. Kate dithered, unsure where to go.
"What number did I say you were rowing at?"
asked the captain.
4. "Okay, so you're in there."
And she pointed to a slight gap in the lineup between two equally tall and slender young women with matching manes of blonde hair. The one in front had an impressive collection of metalware clipped down the length of her ear. The one behind
sported carefully applied eyeliner that ended in extravagant flicks. Kate moved into place.
"Ready to lift? Stroke side, going under," barked the captain.
The crew lifted the boat a couple of inches off the rack in unison and gently started moving it out.
"That's you! Stroke side! You need to go under!"
This was directed at Kate by three with the eyeliner. Every alternate person had ducked under to the far side of the boat, and she was the only one missing. She quickly moved to fill the gap.
"To shoulders! Go! Mind the riggers on the way out!"
At the captain's command, the crew raised the boat onto their shoulders and carefully made their way out of the shed towards the waiting trestles. Having not seen an eight being moved in years, eight marvelled that they could move a piece of equipment the length of a bus and manoeuvre it in such a tight space.
"To heads! Go!" shouted the captain.
And before her brain could register the command, the boat was swept out of Kate's grasp and above her head.
"And down onto the trestles! Go!"
Again, before Kate could react, the boat was being manoeuvred down to one side and gently laid on the green canvas slings.
"Okay, everyone adjust your feet as quick as you can. Beth's here, so we're going in 5 minutes."
Kate was completely befuddled. The commands were like echoes from the past, but they no longer produced a response in her muscle memory. She recalled being part of a well-drilled crew, moving together with perfect synchronicity. It was the only way women could move heavy boats. Men could do it with brute force, but for women, lifting an old boat, carbon fibre honeycomb full of water and filler, the task was at the limit of their strength, unless they did it together. Kate felt like the incompetent squaddy on parade, her foot clicking to attention after the rest of the platoon. If her plan had been to go unnoticed, she was failing miserably. For the umpteenth time that morning, Kate felt in need of a pee. She knew it was nerves, but she was also far from confident in her pelvic floor since having the girls. She turned to three and asked where the toilet was.
"Toilet? In your dreams?" laughed three.
"Try the bushes at the back of the boat shed. I tell you what, you go and I'll sort your feet out. You look about the same height as me."
Grateful for the kindness, Kate jogged off in the direction three was pointing. The ground was thick with nettles, and she lowered her naked bottom cautiously, hovering in an uncomfortable position to stay clear of the stingers. This really summed up her morning so far. Awkward, undignified, and slightly risky. When she arrived back, everyone was standing ready.
"Better?"
asked three. "Much. I shouldn't have had that last cup of tea before I came out."
"Me? I can't even think straight with a full bladder, let alone row."
Just then an older woman appeared wearing a life jacket and carrying a cox box. This must be Beth, the coxswain.
"Don't forget, when we separate, you go to the right," hissed three.
"Ho, crew!" shouted the cox. "Hands on! To heads! Go!"
At the cox's command, the crew swung the boat to their heads and separated to their respective sides, the boat resting on their shoulders as if they were pallbearers. They walked it down the steps to the river.
"Thanks for the heads up back there. It's all a bit of a blur," Kate said quietly as three handed her an oar with a number four painted on the side. "Here, let me."
And three secured her blade in the rowlock.
"Don't worry, you're doing fine. Just make sure you're holding on to that rigger when I get in. If we end up capsizing, you will be my newest ex-friend."
"Stroke side holding! Bow side getting in! Go!" shouted the cox.
Kate watched the other stroke side rowers pushing the ends of the riggers down onto the pontoon and did the same. Crouched on the dock, Kate watched three slip off her wellies, push her seat back on the slide, then gracefully step onto the black rectangle painted on the board under the seat. Having sat down, she secured her oar in the rowlock. With her blade flat on the water and the boat no longer in danger of tipping over, Three secured her feet into the shoes attached to the footplate.
I remember this. I can do this.
Once all of Bowside had their oars in place, the cox called, Two, getting in. Then once Two was in her seat, Four, getting in. This was the moment of truth. Kate took off her trainers and pushed her seat back the way Three had done. She put her left foot onto the black mark. She went to step across with her right foot and wobbled. Shit, shit! She bent down and steadied herself. Both feet in place, she went to lower herself onto the seat. This was easier said than done. She clung on to the rigger and then landed heavily. She wriggled into the correct position and then, holding onto her oar, strapped her feet in. The wooden handle of the blade was rough to the touch. Her hands remembered the coarse texture, the weight and balance of the blade.
Well done, whispered Three. That's the hardest part over with.
Kate was not entirely convinced, but was grateful for the encouragement. Close to the water now, Kate breathed in the familiar river smell, part rotting vegetation and part diesel oil. The gentle lapping of the water against the side of the boat sounded like the voice of an old friend. Her gaze fell on the trim buttocks of Five in front of her. Kate groaned inwardly at the thought of Three having to spend the whole outing studying her own expansive bottom.
Testing, testing,
came the cox's voice through a speaker by Kate's feet. That was something new. At Cambridge, they'd made do with coxes with penetrating voices.
Can you hear me in the bows?
Three tapped Kate on the shoulder.
Don't forget, when the cox says bow four, that's us. Got it?
Got it.
Number off when ready, said the cox. Bow. Two. Three.
The cogs in Kate's brain couldn't move fast enough to process what was happening.
Four,
hissed Three.
Four, shouted Kate. Five. Six. Seven. Stroke. Pushing off, called the cox.
And the rowers closest to the bank pushed the eight clear into the river. The cox commanded stern four to row light pressure, and the four women in front of Kate started rowing. She had to move her hands forward and bring her knees up to avoid the oar in front becoming tangled with hers. She was glad of this chance to observe and remind herself how they warmed up, building up the stroke piece by piece. They began sitting bolt upright, legs flat, and using just their arms. Next, they started hinging from the hips, legs still straight. Gradually, they brought in the legs. With each new command, the rowers brought up their knees slightly higher and slid their bottoms closer to their feet. With each addition to the stroke, the arc circumscribed by the oar increased. Finally, they were at maximum compression and taking full-length strokes. Kate felt the familiar lurch of the boat with every stroke. It was like cantering on a horse, a backwards and forwards movement that you had to ride out. With every surge, she felt her heart lift.
Next stroke! Easy there!
And with this, the four women stopped rowing. Kate knew what was coming next. Her turn.
Dear God! Can I remember what to do?
Stern four! Sit the boat! Bow four! Backstops! Light pressure! Go!
With that, Kate pushed her arms away, rocked over, moved up the slide, and placed her blade in the water. She was rowing. It felt as natural as breathing.
Bow! Make sure you're in time with four, the cox called. She's setting a nice rhythm. Make sure you're following.
Kate almost purred. She could do this. She was exhilarated by the movement and the water. But more thrilling still was being reminded of her own ability, of who she was. Once bow four had warmed up, cox called for stern four to join in. Now they were rowing as an eight. Even though they were using minimal effort, the boat was zipping along. The river slipped away behind the cox with narrow boats and pleasure cruisers moored at its sides. Kate was conscious. She had no idea what the river ahead looked like. It was a curious sensation to be travelling along an unknown river, backwards. To be able to see so clearly where you had come from, but to have no clue where you were going. They rode on, with the cocks making calls to focus on different aspects of technique. Kate struggled to understand some of the instructions. As they progressed down a strait, a number of single and double sculling boats passed on the other side, making their way back upstream. There were no boats moored here. Overgrown willow trees jostled for space on the banks, their branches trailing in the water, narrowing the river. When they finally halted, just short of the weir, Kate was all in. She could barely breathe, and her arms and legs felt like jelly. They paused for a few minutes to drink water. As Kate concentrated on bringing down her heart rate and steadying her breathing, she studied the view down the river, back towards the Albion boathouse. The land to the left rose sharply to an escarpment. A couple of imposing Georgian houses sat smugly on the plain above the ridge, looking south over the river. To her right, there was nothing to see but open countryside. As Kate brought the focus of her gaze back to the river, she noticed with a start the menacing outline of a grey heron, poised motionless on an overhanging branch. In stark contrast to the bucolic scene beyond, the limbs of the trees lining the river were draped with shrouds of blackened plastic. Remnants of last winter's floods, they were a reminder of the river's changeable nature. Once everyone had drunk and talked their fill, they spun the boat and rowed back, working on technique. Kate was concentrating so hard she was surprised when they arrived back at the landing stage. Getting out was much easier than getting in, but as she went to straighten up, her back crunched and a pain shot through her buttock. She was already stiff. This was going to hurt. They lifted the boat out of the water, grimy with oily filth and duckweed. It bore a distinct tide mark. As they raised it above their heads, the foul-smelling water ran down Kate's arms. They carried the eight back up to the boathouse. Bow four collected the blades and put them away, whilst stern four washed the boat. Kate couldn't remember washing a boat in her university days. The oars were stored vertically in the boathouse, resting in the rack by their collars. Bow was making a fuss because two hadn't put the blades away in number order. Two was arguing it didn't matter, as they got jumbled up when you took them out anyway. Once Two walked off, Bao took them out and rearranged them. Kate thought to herself that Bao probably had very tidy kitchen cupboards. With the boat safely away, the crew huddled together to discuss how the outing had gone and what they'd like to work on next time. No one said anything to Kate. She was so overwhelmed by the experience, it was difficult to untangle her emotions. She couldn't honestly say she'd enjoyed the morning, as she'd felt uncomfortable and out of place for so much of it. But there had undoubtedly been moments of exhilaration. No, moments of joy. She was hugely relieved to have survived and not made a complete fool of herself. But it was even harder than she remembered, both technically and physically. She'd have to work hard to regain the form she once had, if it was even possible. As the meeting broke up, three caught Kate's eye and whispered, "Well done, Cambridge, you're in." Before Kate could say anything, three was walking away from the boat shed, her arms looped round the waists of two of the other young women. It reminded Kate of the camaraderie of her old college crew. They'd learnt to row together, won and lost races, bickered and made up. They'd be more like sisters than friends. It was hard to imagine she would ever feel that with this crew. Just as Kate was about to make a move, Beth the Cox came over. She was about Kate's age and similar height. She was probably more slight, although it was difficult to tell under the multiple layers of clothing, waterproofs and life preserver. Her hair was a tangle, but was dark brown and chin length. The hairdresser may once have intended it to sit in a layered bob. She had an endearing grin, and the white lines that fanned out from her eyes suggested a habit of smiling.
Her mouth hardly moved as she spoke with the clipped tones that identified her as from a different world to Kate's, an impression at odds with her stained orange over-trousers that had seen better days.
"You must be Kate. I didn't get a chance to have a word before we went out. You're not
what you were expecting?"
"No, I gathered that."
Beth laughed, and for the first time that day, Kate started to relax.
"How was that for you?" asked Beth.
"You did brilliantly, you know."
"Really? I absolutely loved it. It was so kind of everyone to let me have a go."
"Nonsense. They were lucky to have you. I think it's amazing you wanted to do it."
Beth's eyes crinkled into a warm and slightly mischievous smile as she said this.
"What? At my age?"
"I meant after such a long layoff."
"To be honest, I hadn't realised how unfit I was. I don't think I'll be able to walk tomorrow. I'm stiffening up already."
"How are your hands?"
Kate lifted up her palms for inspection, livid with several large, raw blisters.
"Ouch. Do make sure you give those a good clean before you tape them up. Don't want you going down with Vial's disease."
Kate was touched by her thoughtfulness.
"Was there anything in particular you found difficult?"
"This is going to sound ridiculous, but it wasn't the rowing itself. The hardest bit was carrying the boat and then getting into it. I don't remember it being so difficult when I was 20.
Beth knotted her brows together as if she were considering this information.
"Look, I don't know if you're interested, but as it happens, I'm a physio. I could show you some exercises to help with that, and some stretches, if you'd like."
"Oh my God, would you? You have no idea, that would be just amazing."
Kate was struck how much this small gesture of kindness meant.
"No problem. Give me your address, and I'll drop by tomorrow before you seize up."
Beth smiled and waved as Kate limped away from the river towards her car. She felt battered and bloodied, but triumphant. She had lived to fight another day. And she would. She would fight another day. She was not going to stop fighting.
The drive phase. After the blade is placed in the water, the rower applies pressure to the oar, levering the boat forward.
Chapter 3.
Kate. Kate reached out to put an arm around Tim and found instead the cold, empty space with the duvet peeled back. He must have sneaked out for his Sunday morning bike ride without waking her. She wanted him there. So much. She'd woken up to an empty house every morning during the week, and now she ached for him. She hadn't realised how much she'd been looking forward to seeing him, and how disappointed she was not to have him around. They were so used to their weekend routine, with Tim heading off early to conquer his next hill climb. It hadn't occurred to her she'd feel differently after a week alone without the girls for company. Still, it was early days. No doubt she'd get used to it in time. When she finally surfaced, she found she could barely move. Either her muscles refused to respond, or if they did, the pain was unbearable. She was trapped, pinned down by her goose feather duvet.
This is what it must be like when you're old and have a fall. You spend all night lying on the kitchen floor, unable to move until someone finds you lying soaked in your own urine.
Determined to escape, she worked her feet to the side of the bed and then slid out until her bottom was on the floor. She crawled to the bathroom, turned on the bath taps and reached for the painkillers. After a maximum dose of anti-inflammatories, a scalding hot bath plus several cups of tea, Kate began to feel human again. She was absolutely fine so long as she kept moving. If she sat down for any length of time, her legs and back locked into place. Kate was relieved Tim hadn't been there to see the state she was in. No doubt he'd have told her once again she was mad to be doing this to herself at her age, even as he headed out of the house in fluorescent lycra, cycle helmet and cleats. Self-awareness was a gift not granted to everyone. As Kate walked along the landing to the airing cupboard, she passed the door to Ella's bedroom. She paused and then opened the door to reassure herself the room was clean and tidy, even though no one had been in there since the last time she'd checked. She sat on the bed. It felt quieter than the rest of the house. Emptier. She wasn't used to being able to see the carpet in here. She ran her hands across the damson velvet counterpane. It was soft and comforting against her ragged palms. Kate lowered herself gingerly onto the bed and laid her head on the pillow. She buried her face in the icy cotton and breathed in the smell of her child. She lay there, lost in memories of her baby, remembering the soft skin at the back of her neck that always smelt just like this. Eventually, she roused herself. She taped up her blisters and busied herself clearing up the kitchen and making an apple pie for later. Plus, some totally unnecessary cherry tray bakes. Preparing meals and baking cakes was how Kate expressed herself, and she wanted Beth to know how grateful she was for her kindness. Beth was as good as her word and dropped round after her morning outing. Her cheeks were pink, and as Kate hugged her, she could smell the outdoors clinging to her hair. She put the espresso pot on the hob to brew, and while they waited for the coffee, Beth took her through a series of stretches. They all hurt. No, they were all total agony. But, with Beth's encouragement, Kate breathed deeply through the pain. Once they'd finished, her poor aching body did feel a great deal easier. "I'm sorry, it must hurt like buggery. You'll need to keep doing these every 2 or 3 hours for the next few days. That will help with the stiffness. And keep taking the anti-inflammatories. You know, it's feeling better already." "Grand. There are a couple of other things I want to show you." Beth took her through some exercises to help build up her upper body strength, using a couple of old milk cartons filled with water as weights. That was to avoid injury when moving the boat. She was extremely particular about how Kate was holding herself and making sure she was breathing at the appropriate point in the movement. Kate felt safe in Beth's care. It was a good feeling. "Sorry for being fussy, but it's really important you do this correctly right from the start. By the time we've built up to a heavyweight, you need to make sure you have a good technique." She then showed her how to practice standing up from a deep squat. Doing this would help build up the core and leg muscles Kate needed to get in and out of the boat. She could go through this routine every morning in the kitchen whilst she waited for her porridge to cook. By now, the air was filling with the enticing aroma of coffee. Kate put 4 slices of the freshly baked cherry cake on a plate, and they both sat at the battered pine table.
"This is a treat," said Beth. "I don't ever bake."
"I'm so in the habit of baking every week for my family, I keep forgetting the only person who's going to eat my cakes now is me."
"What about your husband?"
"He doesn't do carbs." Kate pondered the irony of the situation as they sat in companionable silence, sipping at their coffee. "Tell me something, do you row, or do you just cox?"
"Gosh, yes, I used to for years. I was mad about it."
"So why did you stop?"
"Oh, I don't know. My last crew broke up when one of them, Leslie, had an injury. I carried on sculling for a bit, but people started asking me to cox. I sat in for other crews, but I got sick of never being picked to race. I pretty much only cox these days, although I keep saying I'm going to start sculling again."
"Do you miss it?" asked Kate.
"I miss being part of a crew, but, you know, it is how it is."
Kate wondered if Beth was always this accepting. As they drank their coffee, she glanced down at Beth's left hand, bare of rings. "Do you mind me asking? Do you have a partner?"
"No, I don't mind you asking," he replied,
smiling warmly, clearly appreciating Kate's tact.
"And no, I don't have a partner. Somehow it just never quite happened."
She paused.
"There was someone, once. I really thought he was the one. But it seems it wasn't meant to be."
She hesitated.
"And I guess it's not going to happen now."
There was an awkward silence. Kate began to wish she hadn't asked the question. Beth drank her coffee, looking lost in contemplation. She picked at her cake and extracted a whole cherry. She chased it around the plate with her finger. She had the easy charm and expensive vowels of people who'd been to public school. Kate wondered to herself how different their childhoods must have been.
"You realize," said Beth, "you've got everything I was supposed to have. The lovely home, the husband, the children. That's what was planned for me."
This came out in a bit of a rush, like a confession. "My parents didn't believe in educating girls. They thought it would be an obstacle to a good marriage. At school, we spent more time with our ponies than our books. It was great fun, but we all left complete noodles. It was a total fluke. I scraped the grades to train as a physio."
"Lucky for me you did. You're really good at it."
Beth didn't seem to notice the compliment. She seemed preoccupied with her train of thought.
"When you're young, you have this idea of how your life will look one day, even if that idea is someone else's. Then, somehow, you wake up in your late 40s and it isn't anything like that. You sort of wonder, how did I get here? This isn't what was supposed to happen."
"I know exactly what you mean. Life not turning out the way you expect."
Kate paused, unsure whether to continue. She lowered her voice slightly, as if she might be overheard in the empty house.
"You do know things aren't necessarily as rosy as they look on the outside, don't you?"
She got up to put on a second pot of coffee and offered Beth another slice of cake.
"I look at you and I envy you. Living your life on your own terms, doing a job you enjoy and pursuing your passions. It's a long time since I did that."
Kate lifted her head as she finished saying this and glanced cautiously at Beth. She looked intrigued.
"Well, it's about time you started again. Next weekend?
Try and stop me."
It was late by the time Tim limped in from his cycle ride. Kate had already made a start on peeling the potatoes for supper. She put down her knife and staggered up to the front door. She was so pleased to have him back. He was bent over the village newsletter lying on the hall table, clad in red and black lycra.
"How was it? I'm glad you're back in one piece."
There was no reply. Then Kate saw the telltale wire dangling from Tim's cycling helmet. She tapped him on the shoulder and he turned round with a start and removed his earpiece.
"I didn't see you there. What time's supper?"
"Another hour or so."
"How was your ride?"
"Annoyingly, I got a puncture early on, but I managed to fix it. A couple of them waited for me."
"That was kind of them,
wasn't it? Do you know, I'm so used to spending my time at work with everyone out for themselves. It almost comes as a shock when someone's nice to me like that."
Kate felt quite touched by this admission.
"Someone apart from me?" she added.
"Well, obviously, you're my wife. It's your job to be nice to me."
There was a silence that neither of them seemed to want to fill.
"Well, I'll go and get a bath, seeing as there's time."
As Kate turned to go, she stiffened up and was limping.
"You okay? Have you hurt yourself?"
Tim sounded concerned.
"I'm fine.
Just a bit stiff."
"Are you sure this rowing is a good idea? You're going to do yourself an injury if you're not careful."
With these words of encouragement floating in the air, Tim hobbled his way upstairs. Kate sighed and returned to her vegetables, wondering whose job it was to be nice to her.
Bow. The rower closest to the front or bow. In coxless boats, often the person who keeps an eye on the water behind them to avoid accidents. Chapter 4. Kate. By the following Friday, as she ploughed through the stack of files in front of her at work, Kate felt almost back to normal and her blisters were nearly healed. It was only when she attempted to get up to fetch another document that she found her entire body had been welded into place. Kate's office had no window, being in the centre of the building, but instead, the wall to the corridor was made of glass. While this let in no natural light, it did help to relieve the potential for claustrophobia. The feeling of working in a goldfish bowl was harder to escape. As colleagues passed by, they smiled at her or gave her a wave. While she appreciated the gesture,
It was a distraction she could have done without. It was not an attractive office. More to the point, it was not a desirable office. The lack of an external window, the absence of furniture beyond Kate's desk and chair, all semaphored Kate's lowly status within the firm. This was at least part of the reason, quite, so many colleagues waved at Kate as they passed. She was not a threat, so it cost them nothing to be pleasant. Kate had rationalised the situation many times over. She was only in the office Wednesday to Friday, so it made no sense to occupy a better room. She used one of the meeting rooms when she saw clients, so really it made no odds. Except it did. It rankled. In a quiet, low-grade sort of way, like a small paper cut suffered on a daily basis. Over time, the accumulation of barely perceptible slights built up, like the constant irritant in her client's lungs that eventually turned into cancer. A partner at the firm had represented one of the earliest claimants suffering from an industrial disease called mesothelioma, and a flood of other victims had followed. On the strength of this, they'd created a highly specialised part-time job that was perfect for a woman returning from maternity leave. For a long time, Kate had been so grateful for any work that would fit in with her family.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.